What I feel was his more important contribution was his role as what I call an entrepreneur, or a political entrepreneur. And what that means is that he was somebody who really understood the process of how ideas become reality, the whole process of policy implementation and politics, and how to speak to different constituents in the business community, how to get the ear of the media, how to get ideas in front of the mayor, and how this whole process works. This very complicated, subtle process that exists in the world of how ideas stop being ideas and start becoming reality. And I tell the story of Ed Bacon starting early in his career when he worked in Flint, Michigan, through his 21 years as city planning director in Philadelphia, and then in the decades after he retired from the City Planning Commission in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and 2000s, when he was still promoting ideas and using the same methodology to try and get ideas out there. Ed Bacon was a fascinating story, really interesting character to write about, and I hope that even people who, I assume everybody here cares about planning or design somewhat, but I'm hoping that people who even don't will find this story really fascinating, because Ed Bacon came of age in a really interesting time for planning and architecture. After graduating from Cornell, he traveled the world in the late 20s and ended up as an architect in Shanghai in China during a building boom there. And then he ended up in Flint, Michigan during the period of the 1937 sit-down strike that created the UAW. He was there for Roosevelt's famous visit to Flint in the 30s, and was really active during both the WPA New Deal period and the urban renewal period of planning. So just incredible stories and experiences as an individual, apart from his role as a city official and professional planner. But I do think that Philadelphia played an important role in the urban renewal period that hasn't been written about enough. Philadelphia, as I show in the book, had project after project that were these very complicated public-private partnerships. Penn Center was owned by the Pennsylvania Railroad. The City Planning Commission tried to kind of influence this private corporation to do something different from what it wanted to do initially with its land. Society Hill was an extremely complicated public-private partnership. The Gallery at Market East ended up being this very innovative partnership between the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority and the Rouse Company. So, as a case study of Philadelphia planning and architecture and design, I think this was also a really fascinating story. So those are the three different kinds of stories that I tell in the book. Philadelphia did have a redevelopment czar named Bill Rafsky, and apparently he was very good, but he's fallen into almost total obscurity, whereas Ed Bacon remains the figure remembered from that period. So the big question in the book looks at what was Ed Bacon's actual role, what did he do, and why did he become the figurehead of this period where there were so many important players and actors who have fallen into obscurity. The other thing that I try and bring out in the book is the controversial side of what Bacon did. His legacy is very controversial. It's associated with projects where the architecture and urban design has been criticized, and also with the city's highway system, which has been largely criticized. And so what I try and explain in the book is exactly what was Ed Bacon's role in these projects. In the case of Penn Center, for example, as I was talking about, this was privately owned land where a private corporation ended up hiring a developer from New York and an architect from New York, and Ed Bacon was very critical of the architecture of Penn Center, as were Lou Kahn and just about everybody else in that period. And so the question I ask is, assessing the architecture of the project really the way to assess Ed Bacon's legacy? Obviously, I think the answer is no. I think it's much more complicated than that. With the highways, really interesting story, and I'll just close on this, but there was a period in the late 60s when Ed Bacon was going to public hearings and community events and advocating for the Crosstown Expressway that, for those of you who are from out of town, was never built on South Street. And he was there advocating for this highway. And what I found in the archives was that during the same period, he was giving private interviews saying that the automobile has lost its luster as something worth sacrificing for, destroying our cities and the countryside. And as soon as Mayor James Tate stopped supporting the Crosstown Expressway, not too long thereafter, so did Ed Bacon. And in fact, just about a year and a half, 2 years later, when he retired from the City Planning Commission, he immediately went on this international campaign to try and rid the world of automobiles, a campaign called the Post-Petroleum City, which he stuck on through the 90s, actually. He wanted to hold an international post-petroleum cities conference. So the point is that Bacon was an extremely complex character who, at times, had conflicting public and private personas, and sometimes had views that, when you know both sides of it, seem hypocritical or at least confusing. And so the story I try and tell here is the whole story of kind of the public and the private Bacon, what he was doing publicly, what he was doing behind the scenes. And I think it's very different than the way that his legacy has been interpreted to date. I don't believe that Ed Bacon was Philadelphia's Robert Moses. I also don't believe he was Ed Bacon's Jane Jacobs. As a recent review in Architects Magazine argued, my book really talks about how he was kind of a third wheel in this whole scene of urban renewal in America.